gladly. But all I agree as they join the stampede.
To hear your song going with the visuals is pretty exciting.
It's the circle of life.
I must say the animation in this movie is really impressive, and you see this wonderful opening to this movie, and it's the Africa. The vastness comes across with the animation. They didn't just hire me to just write the melodies and then thank you very much, goodbye. I felt as if I was part of it. I saw it and I saw Circle of Life as the opening, I got goosebumps. And when the song finishes, it just goes boom, and you go, oh, and then it goes the lion again. I'm Elton John.
And I'm Tim Rice.
And during the next half an hour,
you will be hearing and seeing
the songs and music from the Walt Disney movie,
The
Lion
King.
Ta-da! You just know once you've seen part of the animation, what they're doing, and the quality of it, you know that you have to really write something that's going to be good. Because if you don't, it's going to show up.
There's been, of course, through many, many years, a great tradition of storytelling involving animals that Walt kind of tapped into. And Lion King just simply falls right into that category.
Music is one of those basic fundamental tools that Walt Disney used in each and every one of his movies to help tell his stories. Having relearned that in the last 10 years here, we have looked for lyricists who could tell a story with their music.
Tim Rice was already at the studio writing for Aladdin with Alan Menken. Of course, he went on to win an Academy Award for A Whole New World. And he was involved in The Lion King from the very early stages, and we were looking for a songwriter to team with him, a musician to team with him. And he said, well, have you thought of Elton John? And we hadn't. And when we heard the name, we thought, well, is it the right mix? And then we started thinking, well, maybe it is.
My age, and you've grown up in this world, and Elton John for 20 years has consistently written some of the greatest songs and greatest melodies.
Your candle burned out long before your legendary.
Here's somebody who's been kind of the tunesmith for the late 20th century, and we thought, of course, why don't we take his songs, his melodies, and pair it with Tim Rice, and we come up with this truly extraordinary songwriting team.
I can truthfully say that I've been a fan of all animation, and Disney films in particular, since I was about five. I mean, I really loved those long Disney films, and I never dreamed when I saw Peter Pan or Bambi or Dumbo when I was a kid, I never dreamed that one day I'd actually be working on them.
I must say the way I write is, and I've written with Bernie Taupin for 25 years, is that the people come up with their ideas, and I put my ideas to their ideas. There's not usually a collaboration. I just left everything to Tim, pretty trustworthy guy. I mean, when it comes to writing songs about warthogs and meerkats, which I've never done before, it's been a new experience.
So It's one sort of melody that can be introduced again if you want to use it in between.
But it's bound to come
back. It's got fabulous lyrics as well. I mean, but it's fabulous melody. but no, I'm really pleased with it.
Elton would come by the studio and say, well, here's a song I've been working on, what do you think? And he would sit at the piano and play, and Tim Rice would stand next to him and sing the lyrics along with him. And as filmmakers, it's really a wonderful experience that not only you have your composers there working with you in a very interactive environment, but that your composer happens to be Elton John, and that him sitting there performing these songs for you is really a wonderful, unique experience.
I never think of songs when I'm walking on the street or in the bath or in the shower. I always just sing somebody else's. It's kind of nice like that because you starve yourself from writing. That when you want to do something and when you're ready to do something, you're excited about it.
I think with words, it's much more of a job. You have to think. You can't be zonked out of your skull. You can't even be tired. You've got to use your brain.
One day, Simba, the sun will set on my time here and will rise with you as the new king.
The story of the Lion King is about Simba, a cub, a lion cub who's born to the king of the beasts, Mufasa. Now, Mufasa is loved by all the animals. He is great and noble and wise, and everyone loves and respects him except for his brother. Now, his brother nurses a grudge that this young cub now, the birth of this cub, gets in the way of his ascension to the throne. So now all of his hopes are dashed for ever becoming king.
When the film opens, we start with a circle of life, which is the big celebration to anoint the cub, Simba, because he'll be the future king. So all of the animals gather and they march in procession to Pride Rock, which is the ancestral home of the lions, where they see Mufasa standing up on top of the rock, watching as all the different animals are gathered.
The circle of life illustrates the idea that we are all bound up together and you can't operate totally on your own. You shouldn't try and change things which are beyond your understanding. You should go with what you've got and make the most of it.
It's about succession, about living, about dying, and the whole circle carrying on.
Far too much to take in here, more to find than can ever be found.
And Circle of Life, if you're going to have a song that's going to open the movie, you know it has to be damn good. Especially when you've seen what they're going to do in the animation.
It's the leap of faith. It's the band of hope. To find a place. To the path that wide in the circle.
The 1-2 punch that we had on Lion King musically was having Elton John and Tim Rice as our composer and having Hans Zimmer as our score composer. Hans, who did the music for Backdraft and Thelma and Louise and Driving Miss Daisy and Rain Man, is this wonderful film composer who brings tremendous emotion to the score.
Hans is one of the top score writers for movies in the world. I mean, you don't tell somebody like that what to do. Hans is such a good musician and he's so experienced at this level of work. I wouldn't dare even tell him what to do with my stuff. What he's done with my stuff has been brilliant. It was his idea to put the African feel in Circle of Life, and it's really made a difference to the song and the opening of the movie. It fits in beautifully.
I think Elton's a really courageous man because he just gives me these demos and then leaves and lets me do, you know, whatever I want to them. You know, I'm just glad he likes it. I was there when he heard what I did with Circle of Life for the first time, and he sort of went, oh, wow, because, not, I don't think because it was great or bad, but because it was different. And it's really nice when that happens to you. You know, somebody does something and it's a total surprise, you know, and it's thrilling.
A lot of times when you write music for movies, you do it after the movies or the stuff's finished, but not this time. This was done as the movie evolved, we were writing. And that was exciting, that was different.
In the circle of life.
Most of the Disney films, there is usually one number which kind of breaks away from the actual setting of the story and turns into a Busby Berkeley fantasy.
Oh, I just can't wait to be king.
I just can't wait to be king. It's a fun track because he's really showing off. And he's thinking, God, this is going to be fabulous. I'm going to, you know, do this and I'm going to do that. No one's going to tell me what to do.
This is right after Can't Wait to Be King, okay. And you and Nala go tumbling down a big rocky embankment, yeah. And you end up in the middle of the elephant graveyard.
Okay.
The two ages of Simba. The young Simba, who is really, really a vibrant, excited, self-assured character, and he's played by Jonathan Taylor Thomas.
But Zazu, they sneak onto our land all the time. Hey, my dad's told me about you. And the slobbering, mangy, stupid poachers.
Ixnay on the oopid's day.
Who you calling oopid's day?
And then when Simba grows up,
wait.
Because of the tragedy in his life, he becomes a much more introspective character. He has a darker side to him. And we have Matthew Broderick.
You knew my father?
Correction. I know your father.
Well, I hate to tell you this, but he died a long time ago.
Father?
Mufasa, the noble king, almost godlike in his wisdom, and so the voice of James Earl Jones.
Simba, you have forgotten me.
No. How could I?
You have forgotten who you are, and so have forgotten me. Look inside yourself, Simba. You are more than what you have become. You must take your place in the circle of life. I think doing voice for animation is probably acting in its purest, most ancient form. It's a bit like, not like radio, but it's a bit like the Greek form of acting in the ancient Greek where they had masks on. In our case, the mask is the animator's drawing.
Scar.
I often wonder, well, how are my voice fitting with Jeremy Irons' voice, who is British and so on? I guess the lions had no real nationality.
Why, if it isn't my big brother descending from on high to mingle with the commoners.
Sarabi and I didn't see you at the presentation of Simba.
That was today? Oh, I feel simply awed.
Must have slipped my mind.
They're very good at choosing who to do the voiceovers. I'm rather fond of the Jeremy Irons' character as well, because I think Jeremy's got such an evil voice.
And he's absolutely right. It's far too dangerous. Only the bravest of lions go there.
Well, I'm brave. What's out there?
I'm sorry, Simba. I just can't tell you.
It's enormous fun. It's very liberating playing a cartoon character because everything that I give is in my voice. It's rather like radio because animation is even broader than life.
Well, forgive me for not leaping for joy. Bad back, you know.
Uncle Scar. When I'm king, what'll that make you?
A monkey's uncle.
You're so weird.
You have no idea.
He was able to just be the nastiest human being on the face of the earth with these little tiny turns of his voice, you know. And of course, Andreas drew on all of those nuances and gave him visually such a wonderful character as well.
Jeremy Irons is so good. He can make anything sound good. You can give him the commissary menu and he'll make it sound like Shakespeare.
In a way, I'm providing, I hope, every now and again, an idea, a bit of fuel to the animator. And the colors I put in my voice, they then, miraculously, I see it a few months later, put into the face, into the shape of the body on the screen.
Jeremy has a very intense look in his eyes, so I try to incorporate that into Scar's eyes. They're evil. They look through you almost.
I know that your powers of retention
are as wet as a warthog's backside. But thick as you are, pay attention.
Scar rounds up or tries to inspire all the hyenas as his sort of troops. And it ends up really rather like a Nuremberg rally, a really frightening sort of fascist gathering.
I must admit, I do like the hyenas, which are Cheech Marin and Whoopi Goldberg do the voiceovers for them. They make me laugh so much.
I just hear that name and I shudder.
Mufasa.
Ooh. Do it again.
Mufasa. Ooh. Mufasa. Ooh. Mufasa. Ooh. Mufasa.
Can you feel the love tonight?
Can you feel the love tonight? You know it's going to be the love song in the movie. You know it's got to be pretty special. And also with a love song, or any song that's a ballad, you have to have a killer chorus, or you have to build it up. So, I mean, it's going to be...
Can you feel the love tonight? It is where we are. It's enough for this wide-eyed wanderer. It's enough to make kings and vagabonds leave the very bed. There's a time for they only learn that the twist and kaleidoscope moves us all in turn. There's a rhyme and reason to the wild outdoors. When the heart of the star-crossed voyager beats in time with yours.
Hakuna Matata, it's a song sung by the meerkat and the warthog, and they really sang to Simba, who is now in exile and growing up away from his pride. And they're saying, it's great out here, there's no responsibilities, nothing matters.
Hakuna Matata.
What does it mean? What does Hakuna...
Hakuna Matata means no worries, basically...
No worries,
if something bad happens, yeah, who cares?
Okay. It means really no problems, no worries.
No problem, yeah. So what? You know, every no problem. Hakuna Matata.
Hakuna Matata. What a wonderful phrase.
Check your cares at the door. Take life one day at a time.
Make our problem-free philosophy. Hakuna Matata.
The Lion King, a musical journey, will continue in a minute here on ABC.
From the day we arrived on the planet, thinking we'll step into the sun.
We don't really have any, you know, changes of differences of opinion, do we?
No opinions at all, really.
No. I mean, there was no kind of mega fights or anything like that, saying, well, I think it should be like this or it shouldn't be like that. I mean, Tim was there when I wrote most of the songs. A Circle of Life was written on an afternoon up in Oxford Street.
That was an extraordinary experience because I'd done the lyric. I think I rang Elton on the Monday because we had the session on the Thursday and said, I think I can get the lyric to you by Monday afternoon. Give you 3 days. And he said, no, bring it along on Thursday. I was actually lying. I hadn't quite finished the lyric. So I finished the lyric on Thursday morning and went into the studio and just watched Elton write what I think is one of his best tunes. I was staggered by his brilliant method of working, the speed of it. I mean, and as Elton has said, if it doesn't come within 20 minutes, he tends to throw it out completely. So there must be literally hundreds of half-finished Elton John songs lying around floors of the world, probably some of which are brilliant, but we'll never know.
I think because you want it to turn out so well, you want kids to see it, you want the adults to like it, and you know the quality you're working with, you're prepared to go to extra lengths to make sure it gets 100% right.
Sunday, the laughs never stop when Bob Saget hosts America's Funniest Home Videos, then on the new America's Funniest People. Join co-host Ashley Johnson of Phenom. It's an hour of family fun on America's Funniest Home Videos and the new America's Funniest People. Now, stay tuned for Home Improvement, coming up next here on ABC.